right, strolls in, and then does documentation by about 2:15 a.m. 2:15 a.m. Okay, and does some very, very nice documentation, which we're actually going to look at. Okay, and from that time when this mTOP does this diagnosis, the other things you see are addendum. Oh, do this as well, addendum, addendum. Then the next documentation is actually by 12 something p.m. So, 11, 10:30 p.m. coming into hospital, and the next documentation after the one by 2:15 p.m. apart from all these small addendums, it's now by 12 something, after just afternoon. And it's a documentation for or by a neurosurgeon. Does anybody say a gap here? It's a very big gap, isn't it?
It's very big.
Okay. Next slide. Okay, so this is a scan. Please, it's going to move fast a little bit, but if it moves at all. It is too fast. I'd like people to actually to describe what you're seeing at some point. We'll play it. So we'll play it over the webinar. I'm not trying to show people something. Can anybody appreciate anything? I can't see where to pause. I would love to pause it to show you something. But can anybody say anything? What can we appreciate? This side here?
Yeah.
Okay. This place, right?
Yeah, yes.
Okay. So what do you think that is?
Ischemia.
You think it's ischemia?
MCA.
Oh, you think it's the MCA territory in ischemia? Mm-hmm. Do you think when you're on call in the number 2, you think you'll be able to pick that up?
Yes.
You'll be able to pick that up? Okay. Okay, well, truly, even if you're able to pick it up, well, at least you can see the patient like this. Mm-hmm. You're going to appreciate that. Mm-hmm. And it's the left side, so you're going to be looking for something on the right side, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Because of the cerebellar plate that crosses, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So can you see why your assessment of the patient is very important? Because when you assess the patient, when you're looking at the sky, you're not looking for a place. So if the patient is hemiparetic on the left and has droopy face like this, which part of the brain are you looking for a problem?
The right side.
Okay, click the way. So, you've seen the patient now, you know the patient is left in the process. And looking at that. On which side? On the left, isn't it?
Yes.
Where's the ventricle on the right? Why is it nothing?
I said it's been covered because of the.
What is covering it? You said it's compressed. It is compressed, but why is it compressed? You said it's an you feel that it's an ischemic in fact MCA territory.
Yes.
But I can't see the ventricle on this side. Why?
Swelling,
yes. So this scan was done by 11:23 p.m. Right? And on that scan already, you can already appreciate some swelling. On that scan already. And patient was Jesus 15 at that particular point in time. Does this ring any bells? Should you start having alarm bells in your head? Is it possible that good boy? And what's this patient? This patient is finally 50 years. They're not finally this patient was 50 years. But somewhere along they were putting 30 years and stuff. But even 50 years is relatively young. A 50-year-old person, you know, as we grow, what happens to our brain? It shrinks, isn't it? Cerebral atrophy.
Yeah.
But 50 years, your brain is still full. You understand? Remember, this is a rigid box. You understand? It has a constant volume. So if this swelling is happening already at that time, is it possible you anticipate that this swelling will continue? What do you think?
Yeah.
It's possible, isn't it?
Yes.
So if when you, by 2 a.m. or whatever, you would hope that your documentation that you came, that the medical officer, the MTOC came and did by 2:15, that the MTOC person would have been interested and say, this patient has actually had his scan. can actually look at the scan. And you will hope that if the NTOC goes to have to look at the scan and say, ah, why is this person in the brain of attack like this? I can't even see this ventricle. I can't see it myself. Play it again. There's something I want to quick. I hope I've been speaking. Please, everyone, look very well. I can't pause it. White. Do you see that white thing? You see something white going that way that you can't see on the other side. I can't pause this even. I don't know. Play it again.
One more time, please.
Here and look here. Mm-hmm. We're going to see white on one side. You're probably not going to see it on the other side. Think, do you see that white?
Yes.
And the white is still on that going to that same side where you have the darkness, and you can't see the ventricles on one when you get to your vascular slide. What do you think the whiteness is?
Hmm?
Okay, she thinks the hemorrhage. What do you think the whiteness is? The royal whiteness. What do you think it is? That whiteness is the blood vessel. It's actually the middle cerebral artery. And it is white because there's an embolus inside. We call it string sign. You see that whiteness, you cannot see it on the left side, sorry. You can see it on the right side. String sign, you actually see an embolus inside there. You can already see the cause of the ischemic infarct already.
Interesting.
Look up for the white on this side. Did you see it? Okay, next slide. Okay, so this is one's really, really important. Can we please all go through this one after the other? This was the NTOX plan. When the NTOX saw by 2:15 a.m., this was the NTOX plan. So, first of all, S-bar, situation, background, assessment, and making the recommendation, isn't it? So, what was going through the mind of this MTOC in terms of the S-bar, looking at the background and stuff like that? Her plan was full blood count, EUC, urinalysis. Urinalysis, okay, I'm sure it can help. Urine MCS, okay. MP, malaria, endemic zone, isn't it? So, do MP for everybody, okay. Clotting profile, clotting profile makes sense. I think it doesn't make sense. Full blood count definitely makes sense. EUC makes sense. Urinalysis. UNMCS, okay. MP, okay. Clotting profile, definitely. D-dimer. D-dimer. Okay. HbA1c. Maybe, okay. So, FLP, I don't even know which one is that one. Yes, now. That's important, isn't it? LFTs, important because patients will be having drugs, that at least have a baseline. Serology is very important. So probably most of them are important. I guess the only one that really did D-dimer. Okay, then chest X-ray. Important? Important, of course. Brain CT, you've come by 2:15 a.m. to come and document. You mean you don't know that they've done the CT by 11:23. You're still wanting brain CT, or you want a second brain CT. I don't understand. Okay, then what next? Normal saline, and then with 5% dextrose, you're giving dextrose to the patient that has something in the brain. You never give dextrose.
Is that dextrose water or dextrose saline?
Dextrose saline, but you never give any more dextrose. Never. Never ever scare patients. Don't at all. Do not. I see this a lot. Ibuprofen. What are we treating? I see it a lot. What are you guys treating? Oh, you know, we just give it prophylactically. Okay. What way?
Yeah.
Then mannitol.
Sorry, let me just confirm. I know you're not supposed to give a hypotonic fluid. 5% dextrose is hypotonic, but 5% dextrose saline is actually slightly hypertonic.
I appreciate that, but from a safety point of view, we'd rather you don't give it at all. There's no need to try yourself.
Okay.
There's no need. Normal saline is everywhere. If you're worried about the patient, you put an NG tube down. If you think the patient is unconscious.
Sorry, I'm not wondering, what's really the problem with dextrose?
Oh, dextrose, you have cerebral edema, so it makes it worse.
That's if you are giving without just dextrose water.
Yeah,
I know. Well,
there's been some neurologists who actually think
From a safety point of view.
They do not want to pass an NG tube.
Yes.
In fact, they prefer they should put the patient on non-dextrose.
Anytime, any day, anything going through someone's GIT is not better than the patient. Anytime, any day. Because the main reason for them wanting to do this is because the dextrose are giving the patient some sort of nutrients. Yeah. You understand? What I'm saying, if the patient can eat, the patient eats, if the patient has swallowed, so the patient eats. If the patient is unconscious or you have queries, you put an NG tube in. Standard. Sorry, go ahead.
Sir, please. There was a situation in emergency sometime last year. This patient came in, a stroke patient, but at the same time, he came in with blood sugar level less than 2.2 millimoles. In that situation, what do we do at that particular point?
You can have discussion then. Maybe you can try and do it then. But in a standard patient, like you're not having those issues and stuff, please just default to the counseling. Please. There's no all or none, but I'm saying default just normal saline. Except, you understand, there's a specific issue that you want to deal with. So, like I said, the antibiotics, I really don't understand that. I'd like someone to maybe educate me one of these days. Mannitol! IV 20% mannitol, 250 mils, given over 30 mils, I give 6 doses. I think one of these we need to do at some point, someone needs to actually come and present mannitol and its uses and management patients who have acute brain injury. Because I see this a lot. What are you really trying to achieve with this? Mannitol is mainly a rescue drug. You know what I mean by rescue drug? Hey, this is a drug. Oh, give mannitol to us, buy us time. We are going to theater. That's what mannitol is usually used for. If you want to stretch it, you can say, okay, give mannitol maybe 3 doses. It's generally not used like this. At least to my small knowledge I have, you know, I'm not too good like that. You know, sir? It's generally not used like this. You can have electrolyte issues from using mannitol. So why look for trouble? It's more of a rescue drug. And if you need to push it, well, like I said, if somebody has new information that I'm not updated, we can actually come and do a presentation about it. Okay? Fruzegmine, I really don't understand
Fruzegmine. The mannitol, the reason is the brain swells, so there's a rise in intracranial pressure.
Yeah, I know.
To maintain cerebral perfusion, if you can reduce intracranial pressure, the cerebral perfusion pressure drops on its own. I feel like the mean actual pressure will drop on its own. So that's a way of managing the hypertension, rather than give anti-hypertension. So it ensures cerebral perfusion continues while blood pressure returns to normal because of the drop in intracranial.
I don't think that generally when we actually use mannitol, that's the way we actually want to use it. That, to tell you the truth, mannitol is a sort of a diuretic. What it does is it wants to dry the brain. You want to dry the brain opposite. You want to dry the brain up so that this volume in the brain, you want to remove some of the fluid out. That's what you want to do. To continue to remove the fluid out of the brain just like that, 6 doses and stuff.
No, 6 may be plenty. I know 3 to 4, yeah.
Like I said, mainly it is a rescue drug. Hey, this patient is in trouble. Hey, give mannitol. We are transferring the patient to theater somewhere. So that's what it's used for, mainly. You can push and maybe give 2 more doses or something like that. But I'm saying we're giving mannitol. Mannitol is just, you understand, like a regular dose drug. Like I said, I don't know everything. I'd like someone to actually, it won't be bad if one of you actually go look it up, see what the latest use of mannitol and how to actually use it in patients with acute brain injuries. To me, it's mainly a rescue drug. And if you're still in big trouble, maybe you've operated and you're still bracing, that's okay. Let me give you a few more doses and hope for the best.
Well, I don't know, the books still talk about it, but you're talking about it.
Fruzegmine, I don't understand.
Like a support for the mind.
Not. Chai.
Okay. Well, sorry, sir. So are you saying it's actually not safe to use the mannitol then? Is that what you're trying to tell
me? No, I'm saying you can use one dose.
Just one dose.
You can give one dose. Maybe you can push to give 2 doses or so, but to give it regularly, 6 doses, you just keep giving mannitol. You can actually get electrolyte problems with this. You dry, because it's not only the brain, you're drying the whole body. The patient becomes what you call dehydrated and stuff. It's more of a rescue drug. Hey, we need to save this patient. Oh, yeah, give mannitol. That's what mannitol is. They gave aspirin. Fantastic. Very good. We don't have hypertension on that because they wanted to actually maintain a map. Well, that map is very high, really. 132 for 145. I thought she wasn't talking systolic itself. So usually these kind of patients, you want the systolic somewhere between 130, 150, average of 140, isn't it? Because you want to actually try and perfuse their brain. and don't have any maybe further strokes or whatever. Map, we usually say somewhere between 90 and 100 or something like that, or 110. Isn't it? No, that's too high.
Yeah.
That's just too high. Mm-hmm. Monitor BP, so look at that. Monitor BP closely, monitor blood glucose for neurologist review. Commence physiotherapy. Update unit consultant and stuff. You were a patient that had a stroke, an impact in the brain.
Yeah.
You see anyone we talk about monitor GCSE? Hmm? You know when you're talking about monitoring vitals and stuff,
yeah.
You forgot that it's GCS in a patient who has a stroke. So from an S-bar point of view, you should probably start with plan, monitor GCS. And in your plan, you can just say if GCS drops or deteriorates or whatever, you have something you're going to do. Call me or whatever else to have. Hmm? That should be the main thing. GCS, vitals. This, then you now bring in all your blood tests and your drugs. But the first thing you should talk about is, hey, monitor the GCS. Very, very important. Because that's how you actually pick that the patient is deteriorating neurologically. You're monitoring GCS and vitals. But that's the actually way to put it. Please monitor GCS and vitals hourly. Monitor GCS and vitals every 30 minutes. You have to give a proper instruction.
Sorry, please, can I ask you, is there now a consensus on what the blood pressure should be? What blood pressure targets your
there's no consensus, but what people are just using their mind.
In that acute phase.
Yes, in that acute phase.
Because you're trying to balance between hematoma expansion
and hypoperfusion of the brain.
Yeah, and hypoperfusion.
Absolutely.
Many times.
Yeah.
So in such circumstances, what's the actual
blood pressure? So what you want to do, you want to rapidly bring down the blood pressure, but please don't bring it down less than 140 or something like that.
Is that not too low?
No, 140 is not too low. With 140 over 90 or whatever, what's the map? With 140 over 90, who calculates? Yeah, you still have
140
it.
140
over
90.
Yeah, what is the map? 140 over 90.
180
over 140,
320
divided by almost 110. Almost 110. Well, usually, what is the worst your ICP can be? What is the worst it can be? 30.
Maybe
how many times you get an ICP of 30? So, if your CPP is going to be 60, because that's what they want to say. Usually they used to use 70, but now they use 60, 65. If your CPP is 60 and your ICP is 30, what do you now need to be your map? 90, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But that's under normal circumstances. But following...
No, I'm saying that following the fact that you've had a stroke and there's pressure in the brain, okay. There is pressure in the brain.
Yeah.
Your pressure, all the normal pressure in your brain is between what, 12 to 15 or something like that.
Yeah. Isn't it?
So now you don't have high pressure, you now have 30.
Okay.
You have 30, but you need 60 to actually perfuse that brain. So that means you need 60 plus 30 to be your map to actually perfuse that brain. So 140/90 will give you that.
Okay. I know that the teaching used to be that you interfere with the blood pressure when the mean arterial pressure is, the time used to be 145, I think it came down to 130. I think they had come down lower than that.
The mean arterial pressure?
Yeah.
They probably
should have. Bother to interfere.
I'm not really sure, but I'm just saying from common sense. But from common sense, you're looking at the pressure within the brain.
130, right?
Yeah. You're looking at the pressure within the brain.
Okay.
You take into consideration the pressure in the brain as well. Okay? So what are you saying? Okay, if the pressure goes up to 40, for example. And okay, let's even say that the cerebral perfusion pressure means 70, for example. 40 plus 70 is what? It's still 110.
It's okay. By the calculation we did now, it's 140 is not bad.
140/90 is not bad. You understand? But you dare not go below that. Because you now have a situation where there's pressure in the head and you cannot perfuse.
Okay.
So, in other words, you need a map to be able to deliver 60, but you must overcome your 30 or your 40.
Yeah.
Isn't it? So, yeah, please, GCS, monitor GCS. Again, back to the key question, who is actually going to monitor GCS? Is it you, the medical officer that's come and written your own and say, I've tried my best, I'm good. Who is actually going to monitor GCS? Because there will be, if